Even though supersaturation is the primal force for crystallization, even though it is at the very center of kidney stone formation, and even though it is the principal target towards which treatments are directed, it has a kind of abstract quality to it. It can be dismissed by patients and doctors alike as some kind of complex, scientifically valid, but unintuitive measurement that no one relates to in a deep physical sense. That's why I'm doing this particular segment. I want to make supersaturation come alive. I want it to be something that everyone can grasp innately and physically. The object in front of you is a hot plate. It could be a fancy scientific hot plate, like in a laboratory. It could just be an electric hot plate that you have in your kitchen that will raise the temperature of things. We need that for my experiment. We need sugar, and you don't need as big a sack as this, but it would be helpful to have enough to do the whole experiment. We need a thermometer, a real one. This is the laboratory thermometer. I saw it on the web. It cost about $6, and it will run from room temperature, or about 20 degrees centigrade, to the boiling point of water, or 100 degrees centigrade, and we're not going to go that high, but we need it. We need a measuring spoon. Now, this is a set of spoons, but we're going to need only one, and it should be scaled to the size of the experiment we're going to do. And this is the size of the experiment. It's a clear object. It could be a tumbler. It could be anything you want that you can see through. And we put water in it. Now, this is work that we're going to do together, and the amount of water should be known. You could measure it in a measuring device of some kind. Maybe it could be a cup of water. But be sure you know what it is. A certain amount of water goes in here. Once you've decided on how much water, then take a look at your measuring spoon. For example, if it's a cup of water, you would want to be adding sugar with one of these spoons, and it would probably be this relatively small spoon here, because we want some accuracy. We want a stirring spoon, a little stirring device. And after you've added sugar to the water, which you're of course going to be doing, you're going to want to be able to stir it from time to time. And this is adding the sugar. We're going to put sugar crystals into the measured volume of water using a measured size device like a spoon. We're going to stir it from time to time, so you need that glass stirring rod. Now, what we're going to do with this very humble, very simple kitchen apparatus, we're going to begin by adding sugar to the water and stirring, and adding enough sugar that, on the one hand, the solution itself is clear, but there's a residue of extra sugar at the bottom. That's where we're going to start. That's the beginning of the experiment. You might say, well, you haven't done anything, and that's not an experiment. That's just putting sugar into a glass of water. Right. We're then going to turn on the heating plate at the lowest temperature, so it heats pretty slowly, and we'll stir at regular intervals. The reason I want to stir at regular intervals is to be sure and suspend the sugar particles. As the temperature goes up, and you can read it on your thermometer, all the sugar crystals will dissolve, and you make note of that temperature. At that exact temperature, the amount of sugar you added with your measuring spoon will be dissolved in the amount of water you put in the cup, and you will have actual concentration of dissolved sugar. The units will be essentially in teaspoons per cup, or however you chose to measure. You then will add more sugar with your teaspoon or measuring spoon, this one I would prefer, or maybe this one. Allow the temperature to go higher with stirring. You'll reach another temperature at which you'll dissolve. And at that point, you will have a temperature and you will have a total concentration of sugar in the solution because you know the volume and you know how much you've added. This is going to allow us to conduct an experiment where we will have a string of concentrations of sugar in the solution, that's your water, at progressively higher temperatures. And that's going to be the basis for not only understanding supersaturation, but creating it and grasping maybe fully, I would hope fully, how it would relate to stones, how it would behave, and why it is essentially a storage form of energy. When you finish the little kitchen experiment that I outlined for you, either finish it in your kitchen or finish it in your head, you'll get a real piece of paper or a virtual piece of paper, which will contain pairs. One part of the pair will be the concentration of sugar in maybe teaspoons per cup, whatever units you've chosen. The other part will be temperature in degrees centigrade. And with those, you could make a graph. This first point is a point on that graph. It connects a particular temperature with a particular concentration of sugar. Because you have a number of these points, you can gradually fill out the graph as is happening right here in front of you. When you do that, you'll find it forms a kind of a curve with a little wobbliness around the shape of the curve. And it would take you a while to fill in each point with your pencil. So I'm leaving a while go. Now you could either leave the points that way, or you could fit it with a curve. You could connect each point to the point next to it. If you're mathematically inclined, you could make a polynomial curve fit and get a function. This, by definition, is called the temperature concentration curve for sugar in water in your laboratory. This curve already has some promise. All the points to the right, if you like, up this way, represent pairs of concentration and temperature that are undersaturated. What does that mean? Well, when the temperature reached a certain point and all the sugar you added was in the solution had dissolved every bit. Before you reach that temperature, the solution was saturated. Not only did it have the sugar in it it would accept, it has extra. When you added the sugar here, you saturated it again, and this is the concentration that you would achieve at this temperature, a higher temperature. All of these points are temperatures and concentrations below saturation. They're below the level that the solution could hold. For example, if I place my cursor right here, I'd say, well, I could make that solution, it would have to be a laboratory now, or I could do it with my volume, my cup, and my spoon. There'd be no sugar at the bottom. You could add more until you brought it all the way to this curve. You have to add more and more sugar till you got it to this curve. Once you got it to this curve, you know you can't get it any further, because at that temperature, if you tried to add more, it wouldn't go into the solution. It would simply be at the bottom. You'd have to raise the temperature to get it into the solution. This is a really big concept. You can make any number of solutions here that are undersaturated. You can add sugar and add sugar and add sugar until you reach this point. When you do that, it won't dissolve anymore, it'll pile up in the cup. If you add more and more, it'll simply make a bigger pile. You cannot change the solution. So this is the line, if you like, of solubility, the temperature solubility curve. Solubility is a word for holding all it can hold. Under saturation, the solution's not saturated. Saturated, the solution's holding all it can hold, and you know that because there's extra solid sugar. Now, I want to do an experiment with you that you didn't do, but you could do this experiment. You could begin lowering the temperature along this arrow. And as you lowered the temperature, you would find that crystals would appear. Oh, you say, wait a minute, weren't there crystals already in the glass? Oh, no. This was a point at which all the crystals had dissolved, remember? This was a completely dissolved point. It's clear. You now add no more sugar, turn off the hot plate, and the temperature will fall. Stir, stir, of course, to be sure you don't miss anything. And as you drop the temperature, somewhere in here, crystals will begin to form. That point where crystals begin to form is the end of solubility. If you did that experiment meticulously from every one of these points, you would gradually construct this curve, which is parallel to your solubility curve. Perfectly parallel, but lower. Between the two is what might be called a special zone. The solution is clearly holding more sugar than you could get into it with your spoon and your stirring rod. You prove that because you've lowered the temperature. This was the amount it should have held at that temperature. This was the amount it should have held, but it stayed clear. This is the point where it turned cloudy. You say, why do you have two lines? Because it's really a zone. If you did this over and over and precisely in a really high quality lab, it would have some variability. And therefore it's called a zone. It's not exact. The part in the middle between the solubility and where crystals appear is called the metastable supersaturated zone. What does that mean? Well, it's supersaturated. You can prove that to yourself. We just did. It's absolutely certain. It's not saturated. It's supersaturated. It clearly has more sugar than should be there at this exact temperature. This is the amount you found that should be there. What does metastable mean? Well, it's clear. It hasn't crystallized out. It's holding that in. But it's too much. Why the sloppiness? Well, because crystallization is a yes or no thing. And depending on the glass, how much you stir, the way you stir, imperfections, anything that would trigger off crystallization could vary this. The zone is called the Ostwald zone after a Professor Ostwald. We've now got some real names. We have metastable supersaturation. We have the Ostwald zone. We have undersaturation. And we have unstable supersaturation. All the points below the Ostwald zone, essentially, you can't make them. You could only create them by loading a solution with sugar and dropping the temperature all the way below the Ostwald zone, whereupon it will always crystallize. So the solution can't exist. It will always form its crystals and go back to solubility, with a bunch of crystals sitting at the bottom of the dish. Now at this point, every one of you should say, I'm interested in kidney stones. I'm 37 degrees. My temperature is never going to change. You have told me something that might be quite lovely, but it can't relate to me. The answer is, you're right. We're going to do a different experiment. We're going to take the solution right here, which was clear, and we're going to be evaporating water. You could just let it sit. You could use a hair dryer. You can do whatever you want. But this was a clear solution. We're going to begin removing water. As we remove the water, you can tell exactly how much you removed, because with a ruler, you can see the change in level. And by measuring the dimensions of the glass or whatever, and a little arithmetic, you could calculate the change in volume. So you could put these points on your graph, same temperature, but the concentration is going up. We evaporated such and such amount of water. We know how much sugar was in there, right? We proved that, you know that. There'll be the same sugar and less water, the same sugar. And you will approach the Ostwald zone in this direction, and you'll get crystallization here. You'll be at a point below the other one because we've set it at 37 degrees. Then you'll get into the zone of unstable supersaturation. This is what the kidney does. The kidney removes water. You might say, removes water from what? I think you may have watched the first video. If you did, you know that the kidney begins everything by making a filtrate from the blood of the small salts, which includes such things as calcium and oxalate and phosphate. And it's a very large volume of filtrate, more than 100 liters a day. And then it removes water, so you end up with the urine volume, which is 1 or 2 or 3 liters a day. As it does so, it creates metastably supersaturated solutions. And that's how you get kidney stones. So let's review what we have here. We have an experiment you could indeed do. You can prove to yourself you would indeed know this concentration right here. That's the point where all the sugar dissolved that you would put in, and you know the volume. You can evaporate, measure the height of the water, and know the changing volume. The solution will stay clear, so it's super saturated. Finally, you'll get into this Ostwald zone. It'll collapse in crystallization. When you take it further, it'll be in a zone where you could never make the solution. The moment you get to it, it will collapse. Collapsing means it'll crystallize. And the solution will hold just what it would hold at solubility, with some stuff at the bottom. Hey, the stuff at the bottom is crystals. Crystals is what makes kidney stones. That's the stuff at the bottom. And that's what we've done here. We've shown you supersaturation, metastable supersaturation, the Ostwald zone, the effect of temperature, which doesn't matter to you because you're 37 degrees, and the effect of removing water, which does matter to you because it's something you can do something about. All right. The business about sugar and water worked fine to get across the concepts of supersaturation, undersaturation. But what do we do when we want to find out about patients with kidney stones? We can't sample supersaturation inside their kidneys, but we certainly can sample the urine. And here is a cylinder. This would be a laboratory cylinder. And here would be a sample of urine, let's say from a patient. And we would like to know if it's supersaturated or undersaturated, and the extent to which that's present. Now, how in the world would you go about finding that out? Unlike the sugar situation, we could make measurements of calcium, we could make measures of oxalate and all that, but that won't tell us supersaturation, that would simply tell us concentrations. We'd have to have some more complex reference point. And perhaps the simplest way of both doing it and understanding it is like this. Add to the urine solution crystals. In this particular case, we're going to use calcium phosphate. It's perhaps the most important of all the stone-forming crystals anyway. You remember it. That's what plaque's made of. You remember it. That's what plugs are made of. You remember it. That's what grows over plaque when the urothelium gives way. Here, we have put seeds of calcium phosphate in the form of brushite, the simplest calcium phosphate phase, into a sample of urine. It'll be brought to 37 degrees, of course, and there'll be a stirring bar at the bottom, but we're not going to draw that in. If you leave this solution alone, it's like the water and sugar experiment. After a while, the crystals will come into equilibrium with the urine. If the urine is supersaturated, the amount of crystal will go, you guessed it, up. If the urine was originally undersaturated, you guessed it, the amount of crystal will go down. If the urine's precisely its solubility, the mass of crystals will not change. So you can do something about that. And here are the things you could do. You could take the crystals out after an appropriate time, long enough that you know the system will be at equilibrium, and measure the amount of crystals and compare this to the amount you added. If the solution was supersaturated, the mass of crystals will have gone, yes, up. If it was undersaturated, the amount of crystals will have gone, you're getting it now, down. If the solution, the urine, was right at the solubility, the mass of the crystals will be unchanged. The other thing you could do is measure the calcium and the phosphorus. If the crystals dissolve, they should both have gone up. Strictly speaking, if it were practical, measurement of the total volume or weight of crystal after a long incubation, an incubation long enough to come to equilibrium, compared to the weight put in to the initial sample, would be a definitive measurement of supersaturation, a direct physical measurement. But it is too hard to do for realistic, practical purposes. There are millions of people with kidney stones. 24-hour urine testing is done in large numbers every day of the year. It is simply not possible. It is not practical. It is not financially acceptable to use for clinical testing so cumbersome a method, whether it is definitive or not. Therefore, it is somehow necessary to use the measurements of the individual constituents, in this case, the calcium and phosphate. I have already said, and I'll say again, if the crystals shrink and dissolve into the solution, this will clearly go up. If they grow and take ions out of the solution, they'll clearly go down. That's easy. But here's the problem. It's complicated to make use of these measurements. I'm now going to take you on a real journey. I'm going to explain to you how you get from these concentration measurements to the final supersaturation that is ordered and sold and delivered throughout North America today. I want patients to understand how this is done so they realize there's no magic, there are no incomplete steps. For the physicians among you, you probably know all this, but it will be a perhaps useful walkthrough, things you know but might enjoy seeing up close. I could ignore this. I could simply pass it by and say, well, crystal measurements are tough. We can use chemistry and leave it at that. but I'm not going to do it. Supersaturation is so important. I want everyone who's willing to stay with me to have a chance to see every step. Why? Because I want to convince people that it is not only crucial, but the way in which we measure it is close enough to definitive. You can rely on it. You can use it day in and day out for treatment and prevention. That's why. The experiment with adding crystals, the experiment with adding sugar, are a kind of opportunity for me. They're kind of introduction, because what I really want to do is teach as best I can, not only about supersaturation as a concept, but about it as a reality. As this shows up on the screen, I can just hear people slithering away. I can hear people clicking elsewhere. Don't do it. This can be understood. This can be a wonderful opportunity for you to understand stone disease once and for all. This is all about calcium phosphate salt dissolved in solution. Could be urine, could be tubule fluid. Yes, the salt, the calcium phosphate stone-forming salt, some is dissolved in the urine. Some is dissolved in the tubule fluid. This is the calcium ion. You remember I showed it to you in my first lecture on how stones form. It's got its hydration shell. This is the phosphate ion. It has its hydration shell. The calcium is positive. The water molecules obligingly surround it, turning their negative oxygens toward it. The phosphate is negative. The water molecules obligingly turn toward it, their proton end, where the hydrogens are. So these are hydrated ions, and this is the salt. If this gets too big, this dissolved salt, too high an amount, you get crystals. You understand that. But it can be dissolved. What does it mean for the crystal to be dissolved? Well, it means it's not a fully developed crystal, it's just a salt. Calcium phosphate ions come together to make a salt. They associate with each other. Given a particular calcium and phosphorus concentration, you are going to make a certain amount of the calcium phosphate salt. That's the pairing per unit of time. And this K on is a time constant. For a given molar product, the product of these two, you get a certain rate of formation of the calcium phosphate salt in solution. Think of it as pairing. Think of it as holding hands. On the other hand, and this is from packing, the higher the calcium, the higher the phosphate. That's the old packing business. The other side of it is temperature. For a given temperature, there's a certain rate at which the calcium and phosphate separate. I call that the off constant, or K off, to produce calcium and phosphate in equal number. And in solution, this is a dynamical equilibrium. You pick the temperature, you pick the packing, there will be an equilibrium concentration of the salt. It'll be the resultant of the formation of the pairing and the deformation or loss of the pairing. Because these are equal, these two rates are equal in a solution that's at equilibrium, and virtually every solution is at equilibrium in this way, you can simply say this equals that. And that's what I said here. This on product equals the off product. Well, once you say that, you've got an image, a vision of the calcium phosphate salt in solution, that's the pairing, being the result of a pair of equal rates. And we can do something with that. We can say that The calcium phosphate salt concentration is simply the concentration product, that's the calcium by the phosphorus concentration, times the ratio of the on or the off rate. You just divide this here and you have my equation. This is very simple. Now, if you remember in the prior experiment, we actually did a version of this. We put in real calcium phosphate crystals. They led to a certain amount of dissolved calcium phosphate salt and a certain corresponding calcium phosphorus concentration product. Now, if you know this ratio of K on to K off, and it is known, that scientists can measure this in their laboratory, if you knew that, and you knew the true concentration of calcium and phosphate, you could calculate the amount of dissolved salt, and that is in fact done. It is doable. The problem is not to know this, it's to know the true calcium and phosphate ion in the solution. And I'm going to come back to that in just a minute. I'm going to call this ratio K on over K off KA because I don't want to keep making a division line. Now, I want you to go back to our experiment where we added crystals. Initially, there was a calcium and a phosphorus concentration. Ka is fixed, it's immutable. At a given temperature, it's just there. And therefore, there was a certain dissolved calcium phosphate salt. That's the initial, or I. After the incubation with the crystals, there would be a new calcium biphosphate concentration product, the same Ka, but there would be a new concentration of the dissolved calcium phosphate salt. This leads to a very useful idea. The ratio of the concentration product is the ratio of the dissolved salt. The Ka's cancel out. Well, you'll say some triumph. You show me a graph, a page full of algebra, and now at the end you're proud of yourself. Well, I am, because instead of measuring the weight of the crystals before and after, that's cumbersome. I can simply do the calcium biphosphorus product in the solution before and after. And I know one more thing. This is at equilibrium. This is at solubility. So, in principle, we could determine the calcium biphosphorus product for the solution at solubility. This whole thing is called the concentration product ratio. I used to do it. You'd get a urine sample, calculate the calcium by the phosphorus, add the crystals, wait till it's at equilibrium, a certain number of hours with stirring, 37 degrees. You get the new product. This is the equilibrium. This is supersaturation. It's the ratio of the dissolved salt to the solubility. That's supersaturation. If this is above one, it's supersaturated. What is this? This is nothing more than the final sugar concentration in your bowl. When you added extra sugar and stirred, that's all it is. This would have been the sugar concentration. So the concentration product ratio, which is something we used to do, not only is practical, but it's instructive. You can use the measurements in the solution to get the supersaturation. This is now a completely familiar statement to you. The calcium biphosphorus ion times our Ka is equal to the calcium phosphate dissolved salt. You've heard this already. We're clear on it. You would think, if I know this and I know these by measurement, I just calculate this and divide by the known solubility, which has been obtained by others. But you don't know these because there are innumerable iron products available. Calcium with oxalate, calcium with sulfate, calcium with phosphate, sodium with phosphate, potassium with phosphate, magnesium with oxalate. There are about 24 simultaneous combinations going on in a urine. So when you measure the calcium and the phosphate, which is chemical measurement, you don't have anything because you don't know which calcium and phosphate are free to combine with each other. You have to solve for all the reactions occurring all at once. They all have different versions of this Ka, and so you solve, so to speak, for the entire mass of salt and the entire mass of ion products. Once you've done that, you can get the individual salts. Well, you can't do that with a calculator. You need a computer. And the program that's used is called Equal2. The spelling is the spelling of the originator. Equal2 is very, very old. It was programmed originally in BASIC. It is still used. It is at the heart of the calculating engine for at least one major national kidney stone testing provider. Probably, it's the one that's used for every kidney stone testing provider. It is robust, it is accurate, and it works. So what really happens? What really happens is this. 24-hour urines are sent in from all over the country to the laboratories that produce the 24-hour testing. All of the appropriate measurements are made. There are 12 in all. Equal2 is used to calculate the various salt concentrations. They are compared with the solubilities to give the relative supersaturation ratio. And that's what doctors get. That's what you get if you look at your own report. Equal2 and automated testing and high-quality national service providers have made supersaturations essentially a commodity. They're available to every doctor and every patient who gets a 24-hour urine test. We already know what it means. It is the driving force for crystallization. To say that is almost tautological. It is the height of the solution above solubility. It isn't that there's some mysticalness here, some kind of magic that makes supersaturation such a powerful force. It's simply that it is the statement of the excess, the amount above solubility. What is solubility? Solubility is the point where the crystals won't grow or they won't shrink. That's the sugar that you spooned in extra. You could leave that sugar in your bowl of water at a given temperature and it wouldn't change anymore. The concentration and the solution wouldn't change anymore. So when you are above that point, you have a power to create solid phase. When you're at that point, you certainly don't. Well, it is a kind of truism to say then that supersaturation is practical, it is routine, and it is the very center of interest in the prevention of stones. Now, I don't want to leave matters here. I want to go on to something a shade warmer than these equations. Equal2 was not invented by some unknown person. It was created by this man, Dr. Birdwell Finlayson, who died untimely and too young, July 22, 1988, of a heart condition. Birdwell was an MD, PhD, the PhD in physics. He was a resident in urology when I was a medical student, both at the University of Chicago. His career overlapped with mine, though he was somewhat senior to me, And so I knew him. I knew him as a fellow scientist. I knew him as a friend. I knew him as a reviewer of my papers, one of the few who ignored the protection of confidentiality and would sign his reviews. He was a blithe and wonderful spirit. He was a very funny man. He was brilliant. He was perfectly honest at all times in everything I ever knew about. He was a fine scientist, and he left us his permanent legacy, Equal 2, which is still used everywhere. And it is truly a legacy. You might say, why am I bringing him to you? Why am I bothering? We have Equal 2, you have your supersaturations, and we're done. I do it because the people who make these contributions are people. They're real. They have a history. And it matters to bring them back. It matters to put them forward. In this particular case, to put Birdwell Finlayson forward into a time he never knew, among people who have forgotten him. So this is my homage to Birdwell, my friend and a wonderful scientist. After all that numerology and algebra and my presentation in honor of Birdwell, you have something coming to you for those who've stayed. And here it is, what I might call the principal doctrine for kidney stone prevention. We've said that supersaturation is now universally available as a kind of commodity. Every patient can have it measured in any 24-hour urine. Every doctor can order it for their patient. This is the doctrine, and it is physically perfectly accurate. The urine supersaturation of an active stone former is too high in relation to the crystals and the stones being made. I've never before, and I never will again, read a PowerPoint slide to anybody. But this is critical. I've laid the basis for this statement. It is not simply some kind of current medical orthodoxy. It is not something subject to the next epidemiological study or the next randomized double-blind placebo-controlled 5-year trial. It's simple physics. It is an inevitable and universal statement. Supersaturation is the force that makes crystals. Stone disease is a disease of crystals. The crystals and the stones being made are being made because there is a supersaturation that permits it in that particular person. If you are a patient, ask yourself, am I making stones? Get them analyzed so you know what the crystals are. Get your supersaturation measured under conditions that represent the life you actually lead. Whatever that supersaturation is in relation to those crystals, get it lowered. Whether you do it with water or diet or drugs, probably does not fundamentally matter. What matters is that it be lowered, whereupon, if that is achieved in normal life as led, and on a broad general average for that person, the crystals will cease to be formed at the same rate, and therefore the stones that are dependent upon the crystals, a reflection of the crystals, will stop being made at such a rate. This is a dictum of physical necessity. This is the reason I did this video. This is the reason I pestered you to think about algebra and equations and sugar and water experiments you can do in your kitchen. This is the payoff. Use it. If you've stayed this long, you've earned it. If you are a physician, trust me. this is the physical truth about stone disease. I've shown it to you. Use it. For those of you who have stayed, here is your reward, the best I know to offer. Here they are, the supersaturation for calcium oxalate, the supersaturation for calcium phosphate, using equal to, measured in a clinical research center for people with calcium stones, that's in red, normal people, that's in blue. Everyone's eating the same food, and supersaturation is plotted against, well, you could guess, the urine flow. How would you most unpack the ions in urine better than raising the flow of water to dissolve them in? How would you better pack them than to drop the flow? Is it a shock to you that the supersaturation rises strikingly as the urine flow goes down for calcium oxalate and for calcium phosphate? What is the dashed line? One. What is one? It is the solubility point. It is the place where the supersaturation is not present. The concentration of the calcium oxalate salt or the calcium phosphate salt is at the solubility. Above that, supersaturation. Below that, undersaturation. Well, now you can see the benefits of all your struggles. This is what equal to can do for you. Let's consider calcium phosphate first. It's the more important salt in stone disease. This is fasting. When the urine volume gets low, under about 100 ml, that's a tenth of a quart, per hour, the supersaturations, especially of the red dots, that's the patients, are above one on the whole. Above 100 ml per hour, again about a tenth of a liter per hour, a liter is about a quart, most of the supersaturations are below one except for a few patients. Why are the patients higher? The volumes are the same. They're eating the same. It's because the patients excrete more of things that would cause stones, like calcium. They have hypercalciuria. My site where this video resides is filled with discussions of urine calcium. They have less citrate, which binds calcium. Again, the site is filled with articles on that. They have more oxalate. That wouldn't matter here. Here's the same thing for calcium oxalate. Below 100, supersaturations goes way up. Above 100, the patients tend to ride high. They have more calcium, more oxalate. They excrete more stuff, so they need more volume. Here's the fed periods, the meal periods of the day. Strikingly, there is far more stuff in the urine, and supersaturations, especially the patients, are really a lot higher. It's because they have hypercalciuria. Some of them have high urine oxalates. They have less citrate to bind their calcium. Everything you could have read on my site would predict this for you, and here it is. They're all eating the same. Think about it. If the patients chose to eat worse. Here's overnight. Urine flows don't go very high. The patients are much more supersaturated than the normals. Well, why? Because they have hypercalciuria, and the calcium doesn't shut off well. Same for phosphate. Well, we've left the realm of algebra. We've left the realm of the kitchen with sugar and water and spoons. We've left the realm of adding crystals to urine, which can't really be done, practically speaking. We've left the realm of equal to, and even the important memories of Birdwell Finlayson. We're in the here and now. This is the final product. Here are hundreds and hundreds of urines collected under identical diet conditions for calcium stone formers and normal people, and they're plotted against urine flow rate, the magic elixir. For patients, even very high flow rates won't quite bring supersaturations all the way below one. You see that? And overnight, it's really hard to find people who get above about 100 mils. What's 100 mil per hour mean? Well, 2.5 liters per day on average. A pretty high urine flow rate indeed. Not astronomical. If you can go back to the site and take a look at where stone risk begins when you plot stone risk against urine volume, it's right around 2.5 liters a day. Below that point, you get risk. Well, that's below 100 mils per hour. These CRC data correspond remarkably well with the epidemiological data that were painstakingly collected and which I display to you from the published papers of the investigative scientist who collected them. If you ever got anything out of anything I ever do for you or have done for you, get this. Supersaturation behaves in real life just the way it should in theory. As packing goes up at a constant temperature, I mean by that as the volume is extracted and the materials of the urine are packed closer, the supersaturation rises predictably. And because they excrete more stuff, like calcium, like oxalate, or less good stuff, like citrate, the stone formers are at a disadvantage. Well, what's the message here? Water is the magic elixir. Water unpacks. It does so in the fasting state. It does so in the fed state when, because you've eaten, there's more stuff in the urine, much more in patients than normals. And overnight, if you can stand it, you can unpack even there. And the patients are probably well advised because there's more stuff. And I know what this stuff is. This is calcium. So at the end of this long journey, at the end of all this work together, we have something so substantial, so powerful, so compelling, so vivid. How can you take your eyes off it? How can you turn aside? How can you deny me? Drink the water. Drink the water first. And what's left over? All these residuals? Well, we'll come to them step by step. This is where reduced salt intake helps. This is where a less remarkable protein intake helps. This is where better citrate helps. This is where drugs like thiazide help when we've exhausted everything else. This is where those fancy diet lists that are on the site, where they help. The water comes first. It's the central pylon. It's the primary pathway. It's the ultimate and most important first step. I'm showing it to you now. I'm telling you about it. Remember it. Take it as my gift to you for those who have followed me through the desert and now have come, shall I say this, to the promised land. This is Fred Coe. Thank you for watching, and thank you for listening.